Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Why don't we all stand together? It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. God reigns. He reigns in this place. He reigns in your life. Hallelujah, Jesus. We exalt you, Lord. We bless your name. Everybody say, put our trust in your name, Jesus. Welcome you to Parkway this morning. Why don't you reach around you this morning and catch somebody maybe you haven't seen in a while, maybe you've never met before. Introduce yourself, tell them you love them. I have a great feeling of expectation in this place today. Anybody else feel that? God has prepared a plan, a way. And if you came here today and you desire something from God, I promise you, he's going to meet you right where you're at. Well, my name's Ian. This is my wife, Megan. And we want to welcome everybody to this place today. If it's your first time, we're excited that you're here. There's many places that you could be on a Sunday morning, that you would come and spend time with us. We know that you'd be blessed. We know that you'd be blessed for being here, not because of anything we're going to do, but because of how great he is. Because our God reigns. Because our God desires to be in relationship with us. So in the pew pocket in front of you, if you're a first-time guest, there's a Connect card. We want to get as much information from you as possible. Your social security number. No, okay, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. We just want to know you better. And if you can fill that out for us, you take it to the back. There's some smiling faces and excited people that will be willing to talk with you and to greet you and welcome you to this place because we're so grateful you're here. If it's your second time, everybody say your second time. We still want you to fill it out because we don't want to miss anything. And then stick it in the offering basket when it comes around today. Amen.
We'd like to celebrate some spiritual news. Hudson Voigt got baptized in Jesus' name. And along with spiritual news, we have natural births happening. Pemberley Brooke DeMint is in the house this morning. Isn't she perfect? And the beautiful Danielle Milena Scott is here also. Great job adding to the church.
Amen. God is good. God is good. Why don't we pray together this morning for this service? Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in our midst. Lord, we know that you have a plan. Lord, we know that you have a purpose. We know, Lord God, that you have ordered our steps, Lord, to this place today. We know that each and every one of us are here by divine appointment, God, for what your will is in today. I pray, God, that we would all be sensitive to your guidance, be sensitive to your leading from start to finish. Lord, that we would follow the leading of your Spirit and everything that we say and do would honor you. I pray, Lord God, that you would bless this service today and that everything that we do, God, would lift you up. In Jesus' name, Amen. You may be seated.
I couldn't climb my way up. I couldn't change who I was. You found me lost, abandoned, hopeless, and afraid. I couldn't be the hero. Lifted me from down low.
Good morning and welcome to the weekly Parkway Church video update. My name is Ty and I will be giving you a look at everything happening right here at Parkway Church. Right after this morning service, there will be a meeting for all Anthem students, their parents, and hyphens that are attending North American Youth Congress. This will be taking place in the large group area, which is just underneath Kids Concessions. For any questions about that meeting, you can see Dustin and Kara first. Tonight at 6 p.m., there will be Harp and Bowl in the sanctuary. Harp and Bowl is a time of prayer, praise, and communion for the entire family. This coming Saturday, in lieu of men's prayer, there will be a men's breakfast at 8 o'clock a.m. in the Angeline Tamil Banquet Hall. There is no charge for this men's breakfast, and the menu will be biscuits and gravy, pancakes, sausage, scrambled eggs, juice, and coffee. We are very excited to be having a back-to-school weekend August 16th, 17th, and 18th with evangelist Luke Levine. On Friday, August 16th at 7 p.m., there will be a hyphen rally here at Parkway Church. On Saturday, August 17th at 1 p.m., there will be an Anthem Youth Ministries block party here at Parkway. There will be games, food, prizes, fun for everyone. And on Sunday, August 18th, Brother Levine will be with us for both our AM and PM services. As always, if you have any questions about anything that we've announced, you can pick up a 411 information sheet, stop by the Parkway Happenings Wall, or visit us online at www.parkwayoc.com. Now please enjoy this service.
Amen. Let's stand together again. God, we thank you for this day, Lord. We're grateful, Lord Jesus, for what you're doing in our midst. We trust you. We know, Lord God, that you have a plan for us today.
I give you glory for all you've brought me through. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward to follow. Now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. In every season, your grace has been enough. And I'm believing the best is yet to come. The cross before you.
Your presence.
make a way where there seems to be no way. Your grace is sufficient. Your mercies are new every morning.
Start to believe it. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now.
up an anthem of praise in this house today. Hallelujah, Jesus. We sing your praises. You've won it all. You've won the victory. You've already defeated the enemy. We can stand in your house today, free, redeemed. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. We exalt you.
God is risen. He is alive.
Let's sing that one more time.
You are the risen King.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory. Me in mercy.
There's nothing that name can't heal.
I am
And it flows to the lowest
for the blood that gives grace. Thank you for the blood that gives mercy. Thank you for your unconditional love. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. There's victory in the house today. There's healing in the house today. There's deliverance here today. Whatever you need, Jesus Christ is in this place today. Ha. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. If you're a guest of ours and this is something new to you, please understand we're only a little bit crazy. And it's great, we're crazy because of what God did for us. The price that He paid, the sacrifice that He made, the blood that He shed that covers our sins and washes us and cleans us and makes our healing available and makes our deliverance there. We thank Him, we give Him glory, we give Him praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The Lord has called us today. Let's give Him glory, Jesus. We give You honor and praise. We thank You, Lord, for what You're doing in this place. God, we exalt You and glorify. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Lord, we wait on you, Jesus. Your name is great, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, as we move on in our service, there's been a call that's been made here today, and as the word of the Lord comes to us later on, let's remember that calling. God wants us to move in our hearts. He wants us to take this step forward. And we're going to have an opportunity to do that. Right now, we want to take our opportunity to receive our tithes and our offering and dismiss for our grow classes. If you're in a grow class, you can. It's in classroom A. You can head out now. If you're not sure where that is, please find an usher. They'll be happy to lead you there. As we move into our offering, we want you to know you can be seated. If you're a guest of ours, we're so thankful that you're here once again to experience this wonderful, beautiful, powerful presence of God. I want you to know as the offering comes around, please don't feel that you need to put anything in. We want you to receive from God and be blessed here today. But as a congregation, this is another form of our worship, how we give glory and honor to our God and we praise Him. And this time we want to pray for this offering. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your presence that we feel here today. We thank you for your power, your presence that's moving through this place. Lord, continue to move in our hearts, God. Continue to open up our minds. We pray for these offerings, Lord Jesus. Use them and bless them. Expand them for the further of your kingdom, Jesus. We will continue to give you glory and honor here today and ask that you will continue to move in our hearts. In Jesus' name.
Greater than the great I am. No fear, no pain. God of which there is no comparison. A God in whom everything resides and is found that we need, or we should ever desire. As we were singing a little bit earlier, I always love it when we go back to some of the old songs, for not because I'm stuck in the past, but there is something very unique about every genre of music. But I'm going to tell you that when the Holy Ghost began to move in a very special way across the face of this earth, and people began to read their Bibles and spend time in the Word and began to discover things that they had never heard about, thanks to men like William Tyndale, who was ultimately executed for his desire to have the Word of God printed in English so that every servant could read the promises of God's Word. It is said that it is due to the faithfulness of Mr. Tyndale that we have the majority of our King James Bible. But it's because of people like this that began to pursue God and began to spend time in the Word of God that they began to find out that there were some very real promises contained within its pages. And no longer did they have to go to someone and bend the knee and kiss a ring and pay homage or give finances that they might be absolved of the debt of their sin, or that they might find better or greater position in the kingdom of God. They found relationship, personal relationship with the Almighty. And so as a result of this, and people finding revelation and enlightenment in the Word, by the way, this is not my message, but as they found enlightenment in the Word, they began to write their experiences. And it's amazing to me that the songs that would come forth, songs about the blood. Oh, the blood of Jesus. You see, the thing that made that genre, that time of music so powerful, and it carried the church from its rebirth until where it is, frankly, today, in need of a fresh wind of the Holy Ghost to blow through her, it's because those words spoke to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They proclaimed the greatness of our God. They did not care about what any might say or how uncomfortable they might be, but they would write words like, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. That's fine. I know. I have a pew voice. The only time my voice ought to be heard is when I'm handling the Word of God. But every once in a while, it's good for us to be reminded that if it was not for the blood of Jesus Christ, if it was not for His shed blood applied to our lives, we would be destined for hell. So this morning, I'm thankful. I'm thankful to be an apostolic. I'm thankful to be a Pentecostal. I'm thankful to know that I ascribe to that which the apostles both taught and lived. I'm thankful to ascribe to an experience, but I want my life. Yeah, you can be dismissed, worship team. I'm sorry. But I'm thankful that I've submitted my life to the principles of God's Word, because it is therein that I find life and liberty, that I find freedom and I find hope. And so I'm thankful for that today. If you have your Bibles, and if you don't, it'll be on the screen, but Judges, the 6th chapter. God has been doing some amazing things in our midst, and I'm so very thankful for that. And I'm thankful to know that as a result of what God is doing, and in the fact that we as his people are responding, that the enemy gets very nervous. And as a result of him getting very nervous, he begins to mess. He begins to look for ways to distract. He looks for ways to cause us to miss out on what it is that God has for us. And so I would just encourage you today that no matter what might come your way, do not give in to the deception of the enemy, for you are the victor. You have won. It has already been determined. And so now we just simply walk in that victory. Judges, the 6th chapter, verse 11 and 12, and then I'm going to have you turn to the book of Acts, the 4th chapter. The word of the Lord reads this way, "And there came an angel of the Lord and sat under an oak which was in Ophrah that pertained unto Joash the Abizite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, The Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor." Acts the 4th chapter, verse 31 says, "And when they had prayed..." How many would say amen to the fact that it is good for the people of God to pray? Not just to talk about prayer, not just to believe in the importance of prayer, but when they would actually pray. And so the word says, "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled," say filled, "with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God with boldness." My title this morning, very simply, is our theme for these couple of weeks: Ordinary Yet Powerful. Ordinary Yet Powerful. Would you pray with me one more time? Heavenly Father, we love you today. We're so thankful for you. Having an understanding, God, of who we are in light of who you are, we thank you for the relationship that you have allowed us to have with you. And today I thank you for the authority and the power, the dominion that comes as one having right relationship with you, being filled with your spirit. And so today we take dominion over this house, over every spirit of fear and discouragement and doubt and offense, and we rebuke it in the name of Jesus. It has no place here. We command it to leave, and we release faith in this house that our hearts might be expanded to receive a fresh word from you today. God, I pray, let there be a fire that is stirred within our bellies today, that we would not be willing to stand alongside or to no longer sit on the side, but rather, God, we would be proclaiming to you, "I'm ready, here I am, put me in, use me today." And so today I pray that a bunch of ordinary people who serve an extraordinary God would realize that when you and I partner together, the powerful really will take place. We thank you for this, and we pray your blessing upon the word in Jesus' name. You may be seated this morning. It's so good this morning that all of you are here. I want to just make mention, it's so good to have some of my family that is here all the way from Elk Mound. And so it's an honor. They actually didn't come to see us. They came for a wedding, and we got some nopties. But it's so good when you have family come into town, and I'm grateful for the family of God that wherever we go, isn't it amazing, no matter where we go, where we've been, we can walk into a gathering of God's kids and feel right at home. But there's something very special about your physical family, and so we have enjoyed some company with them, and so grateful that they are with us this morning, and thankful for formerly Mariah Gorniak, now Mariah Sternecker, and little Charlie being here, and that was who I was wandering around with, so just precious. We are very blessed as a church. But in the account of Gideon here, what we read in Judges 6, we find some very important life lessons even still for today. The people of Israel had been chosen by God to be his people, a people, and we always must remember this, they were chosen by God to be a people that would show forth his glory, a people who would honor him among the nations, a people who, no matter the culture or the cultures that were around them, would walk faithfully and humbly before God in being obedient to his law and faithful in worship only to him. They were chosen to give God glory. It does not take long, though, and you find that God's very chosen people, these people who he redeemed to himself, these people who had heritage, these people who had heritage and stories to tell of God's faithfulness, provision, and his perfect protection, they struggled to stay faithful to their relationship with him. It didn't matter how much God had done for them. It didn't matter how amazing the stories of a previous generation were. It still seemed like God's people struggled to stay faithful to only him. It is here in this context of Gideon's story that we find this context of God's people once again. The people of Israel, God's chosen and precious people, had allowed themselves to become influenced by the culture around them, the circumstances of their lives, and ultimately had fallen out of right relationship with God and had begun to worship idols or other false man-made gods. It is a result of this sinfulness in their lives and the unfaithfulness to the covenant relationship that God, in his mercy, brings judgment and oppression upon his people. And the oppression comes in the form of the Midianites and others. This oppression is so severe that many of God's people had begun to live in caves and in the dwellings in the hills of their country because, as a result of God's judgment upon them, their enemies had grown very strong and would come and harass them and would steal from them, especially at harvest time. It's amazing to me, and oftentimes we breeze through Scripture and we miss the underlying important things that God would remind us of. It is no accident that the enemy, their physical enemy, would always come to harass them at harvest time specifically. You see, we would say, well, of course, because here they had done all the hard work. They had planted the seed. They had nurtured it. They had weeded it. And now it's time to reap the benefit of their labor. And in comes their enemy to steal it. Because why not? They could. But I would also say to you, there is something very important here that we must realize in the spirit. The enemy will always come against you. He will always come against you in the time of your harvest. Think about it. Think about it for just a moment. Why is it that you would come and you would say, Pastor, I need you to pray for me. It seems like my checkbook, the bottom fell out of it. It would seem like my car has broke down more than ever before. We have this sickness in our family. We have trouble in our marriage. As soon as you step into the harvest field to begin reaping a harvest for the Lord. Why do you think that is a coincidence? No, I would tell you it is very intentional and important because the enemy knows that while you may be thinking, I'm just going out into the world to bring in a harvest for the Lord, you are walking into his backyard. You're walking into his garden and you are harvesting, you are plundering his labor. And so as a result, you think he's not going to put up a scarecrow or two to try to distract you so you won't go after what he thinks is his? No, he's going to come after you. He's going to try to circumvent that which God would do through you and then hope that the harvest then would be diminished as a result of the fear and the distraction and the discouragement and the disappointment that would then come into your life as a result of his harassment. And so we find here that This is what is happening, and we find the people of God are starving as a result of this oppression by their enemies and the continual raiding that is happening. And they would sweep in and steal and destroy all the grain that had been harvested so that there was not enough grain for the people or for their livestock. They were in a bad way. And as a result, there comes not only a great hunger, but there is a great fear that comes upon the people. And they are hiding. Understand that the people of God had, as a result of this great oppression, began to turn back to God. Isn't it also amazing that how we as the people of God seem to go through this cyclic situation in our lives, that when life gets really good, when we're up on the mountaintop, it seems that we have a tendency to forget God. It would seem that we forget about our routines and our habits. It would seem that we forget to give Him praise and thanksgiving. And we almost seemingly get an attitude of, I worked for this, and I deserve what I have. But the Bible tells me, the Lord speaking to His people in another place, He says, when you move into houses you didn't build and are eating from vineyards you didn't plant and drinking from wells you didn't dig, you better not forget me. Because He said, in the day that you do, well, here's a story right here. And so we find them in this moment of great oppression, and as a result they say, hey, where's God? And all these little foolish gods that we've carved out of stone and rock and we fashioned with our own hands, they're not helping us. Maybe we ought to go back to the one true God. And they begin to weep and to mourn, and they begin to petition God. And as a result of their continual petitioning and asking for mercy and for deliverance, we find that God sends them a prophet. And I'll just say to you this morning, when the prophet shows up in your life and gives you the instruction that you need for how to turn out of your pit of despair, you ain't gonna like him. You won't like him because you don't want to hear the truth. You want him to say, just hang in there. It'll be over. Weeping endures for a night, but joy comes. And it's true. But joy comes as a result of having an understanding that when I'm in my trouble, if it's not trouble that has come my way as a result of my own sinfulness, that God will carry me out and there will be a greater testimony of His glory. But if I'm in trouble because of my own sinfulness and unfaithfulness, then it requires on my part a change and a restoration in my relationship between me and God, that I might then come out. But we don't ever want to hear the truth. And so we struggle, and we get an attitude with the preacher, and we say, who do you think you are to tell me your life is tore up over here? How do you tell me to do this over? It ain't got nothing to do with that, I promise. If God expected me to be perfect all the time, I would not be your pastor. Now, I'm going to tell you, He takes me to the woodshed and works me over when I'm not, just like He does you. And I don't like it when the man of God comes into my life and says, you're the man. You need to fix this. You need to repent. But if I want victory, I realize that I must make the turn. And so as a result of their great oppression, the prophet comes and instructs them that they need to repent of their sinfulness, their unfaithfulness, that they need to turn away from their idol worship, and that if they would do this, that he would restore them again. He reminds them that he saved them from Egypt, and he kept them, and he can and will restore them if they'll let him. And so it's here within this context that we find our unlikely hero, Gideon. Unlikely because if you were to read all of the story, if you're not familiar with it, you'll find that at many times people have referred to him as a coward. He's a guy that's hiding from everybody else. And we find also within the scripture that Gideon was obviously a man of means, no doubt, for he had some measure of wealth, because it's noted that he had servants. But I would say this to you in correlation to that. It does not matter how much wealth, how much prominence, how much influence you have, when the judgment of God comes into your life, you're going to find that it leverages you nothing. And so we find Gideon, while having servants, while having people who could do work for him, he finds himself hiding and threshing his own grain. And it is here under these circumstances that the angel of God appears to him and informs him of the plan of God to deliver his people from their enemies. It's important to understand that it's from this place of hiding and in this place of oppression that God will raise up a deliverer for his glory, and the people of God will again stand in the place of divine favor. It's in this place of the angel coming to Gideon as he's hiding that all of this is taking place. It's in this place that we must understand that what God is speaking to Gideon, that there's an understanding that the enemy will be engaged rather than tolerated or bowed to, and God's people will stand in their rightful place of authority, but not until true repentance and submission to the will of God comes. And for us today, I would say to you, it is not until you and I live in a place of true repentance, that we live in a place of true submission to the will of God, that the place of true authority and power can be manifested in our lives. But understand that when this submission comes, you will always find that God will raise up what looks to be the ordinary to do the powerful. And the people of God, as a result, will then again triumph. I would want us to notice something important this morning from the text that we read, and it has to do with when the angel of the Lord comes to meet Gideon. And he meets Gideon while Gideon is still continuing, even though the situation is hard and the outlook is not good, he is still working the harvest. Yet Gideon is not where he should be, for you see, when they would thresh the grain, they would not do it at the wine press. They would thresh grain in an open place, in an elevated place, in a hard, flat, surfaced area, so that as they threshed the grain, they would be able to lift it into the air, and the wind would blow, and it would separate the chaff from the actual grain. But here we find Gideon in the place of the wine press, hiding, working, was still gathering a harvest. Yet Gideon, as I said, is not where he ought to be. But why is it that he's here? What is it that we can gain from this place? You see, it's in this place. He is threshing grain in the vineyard. You don't grow grain in a vineyard. You grow grapes in a vineyard. And the only thing that you use for harvesting the precious part of the grape in the vineyard is something called the wine press. And it is in the wine press that it is really nothing more than like a vat. And they would throw the grapes in there, and the grapes would then be crushed underfoot or by some mechanical means to be able to draw out the juice of the grape. And that was the precious part of that harvest. But here in the bottom of this vat, we find Gideon threshing his wheat. I wonder this morning if anyone here has ever felt themselves to be in a place of great pressure. That in spite of everything that you think you know to do, it seems like pressure never stops. It just continues to grow, and it seems that it would almost be easier to go back where you started rather than to continue to go forward, because the pressure continues to mount. But Gideon is down in this vat threshing his grain so that his enemy would not see him and then come as a result and steal his sustenance. And it's here that the angel appears to him. It's not alongside of the place of hiding. It's at this place of hiding. In his place of persecution, in his place of lack and fear, that the message from God comes to this man. The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor, you mighty man of fearless courage. Me, the guy hiding in a hole in the ground? Fearless courage? Me? Are you sure you have the right individual? How amazing is it, though, that when the word of the Lord comes to us as people, he comes to us and he does not just speak to us from where we currently are. He doesn't speak to us from where we've been, but he stands in a place of which he's calling us to, and he begins to make declaration and proclamation from a place in our future that we might be motivated to get up and move into the promises that he has stated for us. And so this is where Gideon finds himself. He finds himself in this place of fear and hiding. And the angel comes to him and calls him this mighty man of valor. You, I have fearless courage. And Gideon gives him all the reasons why he's got the wrong guy. But can you imagine, though, for a moment, what probably went through Gideon's mind when he hears these words, all the questions that immediately came to his mind, all the frustrations of why now, God? Why couldn't you have done this last year? Why couldn't you have came a little bit sooner? Yet the message from God is very clear. You have been chosen to do something powerful for the glory of God. How many times do we as the people of God doubt God's word and then limit his ability or his strength as a result of a comparison to ourselves? How many times do we limit him because of that? We look to explain the infinite with the finite. We look to bring God to our level and as such limit him according to our own weaknesses. Well, I don't know, God, if you can really do that, because here's me. And God's saying, yeah, but if you would submit to me, I would. But yet we struggle. But we forget that my Bible says that it is in my weakness that his strength is made perfect. You see, it's in this place of submission to the power and the will of God that what was once weak and unable and the wrong choice that all of a sudden becomes empowered to do what is extraordinary through God. So we know that in our weakness, his strength is made perfect. Does that mean that it is in this moment of when I cannot physically do anything that he's able to show off his strength? No, it's in the moments when you really could take care of the situation yourself, but you submit the situation to God and allow God to do what he would do rather than you taking control and doing it yourself. It's in that moment that his strength is made perfect in our lives. You see, I can do nothing. I must remember, I must realize that I can do nothing on my own, but that everything I would do and everything that I would accomplish would be done in and through him. And it's in this recognition, it's in this walk of submission that the power then is able to be vested in my life and it's able to come through my life. The Apostle Paul makes a statement in another place and he says that we would do all things, whether it's eat or drink or live, whatever it might be, that we do all in the name of the Lord for what? For the glory of God. It's always about the glory of God. Gideon, so he became who we know him to be, the mighty man of fearless courage, not because he stood up on his own strength and ability, but rather because he submitted to the will, the purpose, the direction of God. It is because having an understanding that God would do the miraculous for his glory that Gideon was able to release what would appear to be weakness for strength. Gideon was going to do battle. God calls him and tells him, hey, you're going to do battle against the enemy. And, oh, by the way, your enemy is arrayed with over 130,000 soldiers. And you need to rally the troops and you need to go and fight them, for I'm going to give you the victory. And so Gideon makes the call to the people of God and says, I need some people who are willing to help me fight. And we know that in that day he gathers 32,000 men. Now, it still seems like overwhelming odds, right? We understand. And for those of us that know the story, knows that God said, too many. too many, until he's left with 300. 130,000 plus against 300. Really? You couldn't have just let us add to 30,000. We'd have still gave you the glory. But you see, God is jealous over his glory. God is jealous over who gets praise for what he does. And as a result, he knew that if he could whittle that down, there would be no way anybody could take credit for what had happened in that day. And so we know the story. And if you don't, please read Gideon 6 and 7 and 8. But you would find that they go out to do battle, and their enemy is scattered and overwhelmed and ultimately defeated by 300 men. We often, though, find ourselves in a place of similar situation with God. God calls to us and says, a missionary comes through, and we feel the tug of God at our heart to put in the offering more than we normally would put in the offering, and we begin to justify why that ain't God. That's just my emotion playing games with me. God would never require me to put my very last dime in the offering plate. No, there's no, and we could run right down the list this morning. But we in our own intellect would begin to argue with God and bargain and negotiate with God all the reasons why that can't be you that's talking to me to make this kind of sacrifice. We begin to tell God that the current way that I'm walking, this current pressure that I'm feeling, this can't be from you. Why would you ever subject me to this? And so then rather than giving God glory in the midst of the test, we begin to ask God to release us from the test. How many of us have ever prayed? Now, before you get excited and raise your hand, listen to the whole question. By the way, our Bible quizzers are doing really good. They won again this morning. They're doing really good. Sometimes in Bible quizzers, when they begin to read the question, they hit the button and it's like interruption. And then they got to remember a whole lot more and then they mess it up. So don't interrupt, okay? But how many of you today would say that you have prayed in the midst of one of the worst storms of your life and you have asked God this question? Will you release me from this? How many of you have asked this question? God, why am I here? And what is it that you hope to gain from this? I would dare say that many of us never get to that place. And some of us, when we do get to that place, it takes us a long time to get there. But I would say to you this morning that the Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord. Therefore, I don't believe in just sheer coincidence. This just happened. I believe that everything that comes into my life has to clear the desk of God. He gives access to me for everything that happens in my life when I'm walking according to his will. Therefore, when I find myself in the storm, rather than me coming to God saying, God, really, this can't be of you, so would you please release this from me? We should rather be saying, God, what is it you hope to do through this situation? What is it you hope to reach? What is it hope that you hope to accomplish? And I would say this to you this morning. I hesitated to do this, but I can list names of families in this church that have lost loved ones, that have went through tremendous suffering. And they have all increased my faith as a result of them saying, you know what, I don't know what God's trying to do, but we're trying to look. And while we're laying here in the hospital, who can I pray for? There's people that are in this congregation today as a result of someone here who was laying in a hospital or in a rehab center and began to talk about the goodness of God, and a connection was made, and now there's somebody added to the kingdom here today. I went up and seen somebody just the other day at the hospital. They've been there for almost a week now, laying in bed, hurting, suffering, all kinds of stuff going on. They can't quite figure out what's going on. And I said, what you been doing since you've been laying here? Well, I've been thinking. Well, that's good. What you been thinking about? Well, lots of stuff. But, oh, by the way, there's this guy across the hall from me. I hear him and he coughs really bad and he moans and he every once in a while I hear him say, help. And I've been thinking about asking the nurse if I could go pray for him. Now, all of you nurses, please just bear with me. I said, why would you ask them? Because they're probably going to say, well, maybe don't go in there. Don't ask them. Just go over there and pray for them. And then if they say, don't go pray for them anymore, then don't go pray for them anymore. But it's in these moments. And so the brother said, you know what? I'm going to do that. I don't know why sometimes we find ourselves in the situations that God allows us to be in. But I can promise you this. When you are walking in such a way to honor God, there is something that God is trying to do both in you and through you as a result of that situation. I would even say this to you. Brother John Enjubis went on to be with the Lord here just not very long ago, and I think it's all right that I say this, but I dare say that there was hardly a caregiver that walked into his room that he didn't say, I want to pray for you. And he was suffering. Can I be that person? That God, when I'm in the wine press and I'm feeling the pressure of my enemy, why is it that I'm here? What is it you're looking to squeeze out of me for your glory? What is it you're wanting to do that you might receive the glory? And so it's in these moments when we wonder what God is doing, that if we would look around to see what he would have us to do, that we would be faithful, that we might be obedient, it's in these places that he might then be able to do something powerful through us who are just simply ordinary people. As I said, God did not allow Gideon to go into battle with 32,000 people because he desired the glory for himself. The simple thought for you this morning is, what would it take? What would it take for your life, for my life, to go from being ordinary to powerful? What would it take? What would it take to go from the mundane, routine relationship that we have sometimes as believers to a hot, passionate, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ that is followed with a demonstration of the Spirit? What would it take? What would it take for that to happen? In what ways has God been dealing with you to submit to his will, that he might be able to perform in your life his plan and his purpose? How many times have you found yourself arguing with God or reasoning within yourself that it couldn't be God, and therefore still continue to ask God, God, when will you do this? How can you do this? Would you allow this to happen in my life? And God's saying, I'm trying to work you to a place, but because you won't submit, can't lead you there. I can't draw you there. How have we been responding to that drawing? How have we been responding to that sacrificial commitment? But there's something very beautiful about Gideon hiding in the wine press, threshing his harvest, that correlates to us today. And it would be simply this: no matter the circumstances of life, no matter how bad it looks, no matter how bad it seems, no matter how bad it feels, no matter how bad it really is, in every one of our situations, we can still reap a harvest. Whether I live or I die is gain, the Apostle Paul says. I do all as unto the Lord, right? Why is that? Because I know who has redeemed me. I don't live here for today. I don't live today for here. I live today for tomorrow. I live for what I'm laying up for all of eternity. I live because he loved me and gave me life. It's in these times of great pressure and seemingly at times unbearable pressure that when you and I turn to God and again submit ourselves to him, it's in these moments that we find the victory for our lives. It's in these moments that we find victory over the very things that we've been dealing with. This morning, I can't help but wonder, how much liberty do we miss because we do not give ourselves to be in captivity to to the King. He freed us from sin, that we might be slaves unto righteousness. Yet somehow in that context, we want to tell the Master what we will and what we won't do. And then we wonder why the favor and the protection and the blessing and the positioning does not come. But it's because, again, we have not walked and found ourselves in a place of submission to the Spirit. In Acts, the fourth chapter, and we read the text this morning, but in Acts, the fourth chapter, you would find that Peter and John have just came to the gate beautiful, and the lame man is seated there asking for alms, and the miracle is worked, and the man goes leaping and praising into the temple. And as a result of this miracle, Peter and John are called before the religious leaders. And they're challenged as to why this happened. How did this happen? What did you do to make this happen? And the Bible says Peter, being filled with the Holy Ghost, began to preach. And he began to preach Christ the Messiah, that he had come. He preached the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And as a result of his preaching, they are stirred, but they command them not to preach in the name any longer. And they release them. How many of us would then use that as our ticket to say, well, I guess I can't outreach anymore because the officials told me to stop it? I wish I had a piece of paper. I'd crumple it up and drop it. Dramatic effect. The Bible says that Peter and John went and gathered with the other believers, and they talked about what had happened, and they prayed. And they prayed for boldness. They didn't pray that God would protect them and that God would reveal the word and that God would use them in a different way that didn't bring trouble to them. They prayed that God would give them boldness. And the Bible then says that the place where they were gathered was filled with the Spirit, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm going to tell you this morning. Here comes the prophet down your row. Most of our problems, all of our problems, are because we're probably not full of the Holy Ghost. Whether you've been walking with God for a long time or you've never received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it's because you're not walking yielded according to the Spirit. And so this morning, I can't help but think, it would be the best thing for each and every one of us to get to the place that we would once again submit ourselves to God and allow ourselves to be filled to overflowing with His Spirit, that we might be endued with fresh power, that we might be willing to stand and be counted among the witnesses of God, that we would not be worried about shame and rejection and despisement, that we would say, I'm going to share it wherever I go. So this morning, in closing, I would just simply say this to you. God is all about Himself. I've made statements in the past that it would seem by current definition and popular definition that God is an egomaniac. He's pretty full of Himself. He says he looked to his right, he looked to his left. There's nobody like him. There's nobody beside him. There's none like him. He's jealous for his own worship. But I would even say this to you. God defers judgment in your life, not because he loves you. Now, don't get me wrong. He does love you. And he's a kind and merciful God. But he defers judgment in your life because of his glory. And you say, well, preacher, I don't know if I agree with that. Well, that's okay. You don't have to. I got Bible for it. Isaiah, the 48th chapter, verses 9 through 11, probably. But the Lord is deferring his anger upon the people for this reason and this reason only. He said, for my name's sake, I will not destroy. I will tell you, with the children of Israel, they vexed God so much that God tells Moses, get out of the way and I'm going to obliterate them. And I'll start over with you. And Moses contends with God to not do it. And how does he get away with it? He talks to God about his glory. So this morning, this is where it gets exciting for me. Okay? This is where, as a pastor, I say, if the people of God ever really get an understanding of who they are, if they ever really get an understanding of who they are, they won't be down in here. Hey, would you like to know about Jesus? He really is amazing and powerful. They wouldn't be bashful about it. They wouldn't be fearful of the retribution that might come as a result of taking a stand for God. They would step out and be bold. Is it possible that we as the people of God sometimes allow the voices of our current culture? And I talked a little bit about this last week, about political correctness, that we get so careful about what we say that we've put so much water in our message that there's no way there's any life left in it. I'll have you stand with me this morning because I want to be careful for this reason. I know, just like when I was walking around this morning with little Charlie and we saw these beautiful children on the screen this morning, I cannot grill up, you know, a 10-ounce T-bone and feed those kids that. It just ain't going to work. They're going to choke. They're going to die. And we have to be careful, and we have to get them to the place that they're able to take that nourishment. What I would like to say to us as the people of God is God has called us to be overcomers, to do the powerful, to do the things that blow your mind. I spent days with a man here just a week or so ago that has prayed with and saw over 500,000 people filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now, I don't care if you believe me or not. I can tell you it happened, and I can tell you it's documented. I can tell you he's seen every miracle in the book of Acts come to place in his life, in his presence or under his hand. And I say, well, la-di-da. How come I'm not seeing it? And you ought to be saying, how come you're not seeing it? But is it possible that because of the voices in our lives, it's allowed us to become distracted by what the enemy is offering to us, that we've missed what God has said? This is your lot. This is who you can be. You can walk in victory. You can walk in power. You can walk in favor. But you must submit to do the powerful. So today, I felt in the Holy Ghost during worship, we had the gifts in operation this morning, and I would tell you that I felt that God would say this to you. Not to diminish anything that was already said, but I would say this. We came to a place this morning that God moved into this house. I didn't know where I was going today. I had no idea where I was going today, and there's a reason for that. But God called us to a place this morning, and we got really close. And then God speaks to us. And I'm going to tell you that when tongues and interpretation come in, it is always for the unbeliever. And not the unbeliever that's never repented of their sins, been baptized, and filled with the Holy Ghost. It's for every unbelieving believer that'll stand where they are and say, yeah, well, that's a whole lot of hype and emotion. And I'll say this, we heard this morning, I love, but you have to come. And I'm going to tell you, this is what God would have finished with. And you ain't going to like your prophet this morning. But you have not because you don't want it. Now, here comes the shepherd. You can want it. And I believe that you want it. But you have to be willing to go after it. You have to be willing to submit to God. You have to be willing to say, as in the first when you came to Him, God, whatever you want to do with my life, whatever you require, I'll do it all for you. I'll give it all to you. We've made so many vows over the course of our walk with God, we can't even remember them. But today, I would say this. Looking at a bunch of ordinary people with normal problems, normal hurts, normal burdens, we ain't living for here. We're living for a grand place. We're living for a place where there's peace and joy, where there's celebration, where there's no partying. But while I'm here, the enemy is going to look to oppress, to circumvent what God is trying to do in my life. So I say this to you. For the last 2 weeks, I know, I say this very carefully, I know that I have been under spiritual attack. It has manifested itself the same way. It goes away, and then it comes back. And here's what I'm going to tell you. And this is going to sound like a cavalier statement, but I mean this from the bottom of my heart. I really don't know why the enemy would continue to try to distract. Because I'm going to do what I have to do. Now hold on. But I believe that's the same about you. But I do know this, and I've come to recognize this. My giftings, my abilities, they only carry you so far. And it's in the place where we as people recognize our weakness, our need for the power and the grace of God in our lives, that those everlasting arms come underneath and they undergird us. And we're able to stand up and look the devil in the face and poke him right in the eye and say, "You thought I was going to stay down, but I'm going to get back up, and I'm going to keep fighting, because I am no ordinary believer. I am powerful because of the infilling of the Holy Ghost, because of a demonstration and identification of the Spirit of God in my life." And so this morning to the church I say, are you tired of getting run around in circles by life? Are you tired of being tired? Your problems aren't going to go away. Your battles aren't going to diminish. As a matter of fact, they're going to get worse. But this is what I want you to think. You have to remember this. Every time the enemy comes against you, it's not because you did something wrong. It's because you're plundering his kingdom. And as a result, he's looking to distract you. I want to be powerful. I don't want to be ordinary. I want to be full of the Holy Ghost. So I say to you this morning, will you come? Will you recommit yourself? I know you failed. Me too. But oh, the grace of God, the mercy of God that would draw us, that would say, "Come unto me, all ye that are weary. Let me give you rest." This morning, he desires to anoint you. He desires to fill you. If you are here this morning and have never been baptized in the name of Jesus, if you've never received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it can happen for you today. Will you submit to him? Will you submit to him? Make the commitment. My life is for your glory. Use me for your glory today.